Hey everybody, it's your boy The Cho. I'm sorry I hadn't been on the podcast for 2 weeks. I'm on vacation right now with my family. If you're just listening to this audio wise, you can probably tell, you can probably hear beach stuff in the background. I'm at the beach, taking some time off, trying to get my head straight, hanging out with my little niece. I just wanted to pop in to tell everybody on the podcast that we're about to start touring very soon. So we'll be plugging those dates. We just started booking some stuff. Very excited about it. But right now, what we definitely have confirmed, DJ Lewis, huge friends of the podcast, and our very own Drew Morgan will be at the Raleigh Improv on May 27th and Zany's in Nashville on June 3rd. In order to get those tickets, normally I'd say, hey, go to WellRedComedy.com, and I want you to do that. Just sign up for our newsletter because we're going to be going back on the road. But to get tickets to see Drew and DJ May 27th at the Raleigh Improv and June 3rd at Zany's in Nashville, you're going to want to go to DrewMorganComedy.com. Go see them boys. Tell them I love them. On this episode today, Paige Crowder stops by to talk about a lot of things, one of which is her watching her brother Trae whip a middle schooler's ass. It was a fun episode. I'm so glad that I was back. I have missed y'all. And thank y'all for supporting me and continuing to support me. I've had some struggles these past couple weeks, and thank y'all for being a very supportive audience. And I love you, and I'll see y'all next time. Listen to this episode. It's great. Skew!
They're the liberal rednecks. They like cornbread, but sex. They care way too much, but don't give a fuck. They're the liberal rednecks. That makes some people upset, but they got three big old dicks that you can suck.
Yeah, well, I'm experiencing right now the thing that kind of always happens to me on vacation, and I could see this happening to you, where like vacation can actually fuck you up like the first day, because like you go, you're like, I'm on vacation, I'm gonna let loose, and like I'm gonna have pie for breakfast, I'm gonna eat everything in the world, I'm gonna drink all goddamn day long, and then the next day you wake up and you go, I am depressed, and this vacation is not even fun right now. So like I'm having to spend a whole day of my vacation vacationing from the vacation so that I can be good. So I'm doing a podcast.
And there's only two ways out in that moment.
Keep going.
I've done this. I got to take a day off from my vacation and ruin a whole day. Or.
Yeah. Keep going.
Keep going.
I chose take the day off just because I was like, well, I'm doing this podcast anyways. This will be, you know, I need to be productive. I told myself, I was like, hey, you know, you can, because you do everything remotely, you can still work and be productive while on vacation. So I'm going to try to dedicate myself to that. But like, oh my God, son, yesterday,
you call yourself the Cho.
When I tell you it was shrimp, woo, although there's not any shrimp left in Orange Beach. I ate them all.
Good.
Yeah.
There is Orange Beach.
Gulf Shores-ish. It's like, okay. It's like how Destin and Seaside are, pretty close. Like, it's the same as that with Gulf Shores. So, you know, just trash.
It is people. Trash.
Yeah, it hits.
I never
I mean that
there.
As a compliment.
I've only ever been to, you know, fucking Daytona, PCB, West Palm, Fort Lauderdale, all that. But I ain't never been. I drove to Destin on accident once trying to get home from PCB in the era before GPS.
Yeah.
Using like a road map, and I have a terrible sense of direction, and I drove to fucking Destin before I realized I was going the wrong way. So that didn't hit, and I don't remember anything about it. Never been to Gulf Shores.
Yeah, sorry I look bad too, because the you won't believe this, but the lighting in an Alabama condo, not optimal.
Well, this is where I live, and it looks like I'm just in a mental health facility just lying the whole time. I've been doing with DJ.
How long have you been there? I guess since the Friday you left L.A.?
Yeah.
Or whatever day that
was? No, I came here Monday because I went home first to mom and dad's. So I've been here, But I mean, dude, I've only slept here 3 nights. I mean, me and DJ went down to Alabama. We went and saw Key Bump. Then we went and did that show. Flames, boys, live comedy. Turns out, still rules.
Still hits. That wasn't your first show back though, right?
No, I did stand up live Thursday on like a house show. Lucy let me close it down, and they just said do whatever you want. I think in them doing 25,
rough.
And it was it wasn't our crowd, obviously. I mean, I didn't even announce it, and man, it is so fun. People are dying. to hear it, to have fun and be entertained. But we're divided. I mean, like, I did a joke about how divided we are, and they was definitely, I mean, I even had to comment on how, like literally black people and white people was looking at each other like,
Right.
Telling the truth. But they were laughing. I was looking at these rednecks right in their face saying, I fucking hate your guts. And they were dying laughing. So, you know.
Yeah, I've been thinking a lot about it lately because I've been, like, writing my set. Because, like, it's getting close to, like, us. What, Trae?
You hear what he said? He said, Lisa, yeah, was black people at rednecks and right in their face going, I fucking hate your guts. It was just very,
that,
it was,
you
it
know,
was funny.
You know why that just, like, I, of course I heard him say that, but that didn't, like, that wasn't really that
just
shocking.
Right,
like,
over you.
I didn't. Yeah.
I rope-a-doped him.
Please,
I mean, liberals and got them laughing, and then I got the mamaw at their table on my side.
Yeah.
And then I went in, and they loved it. They took pictures with me after the show.
Yeah. So, please don't think I was
on the boat. We just can't pretend we like each other.
Yeah. Please don't think I was no selling that as if it wasn't funny. But, like, that's the most normal thing I've heard. Like, when Drew said, I was like, yeah, of course. Of course he did.
No, I know. I mean, that's why I laughed at it, because of the Raven Red.
My favorite part, man, I do miss doing shows not in front of people who adore you. I know that's hard, but I got a redneck to clap for me wanting to fuck Sam Elliott.
Nice.
And then I was like, I tricked you, motherfucker. And he hated that.
That actually is the perfect example. Like, if you're wanting to trick a redneck into, like, some gay shit, like, would you fuck Sam Elliott? They're like, out of respect, God, I mean, I'd let him fuck me.
Yeah.
Or, like, what could I do? You know
Nobody
what I'm saying?
Fuck Sam Elliott, but I'd get fucked.
I'd get fucked by Sam Elliott. God damn it. You wouldn't fuck Sam Elliott, you fucking queer. God damn.
That's all fun. Let me say real quick, the next day we went and did that show with Mike Cooley and Lee Baines and the Glory Fires. And buddy, it was red. DJ got ant bites on his feet. Then he turned the bottom of his feet in the.
So it's ant bites, is what it is.
So he jumped at it's both.
DJ said earlier in the text thread that he has stank foot. That's
yeah,
what he said.
I saw
said,
that.
I got the stank foot, and uh-huh. You know, I was like, yeah, DJ got stank foot. That's why. But so it's even. It's so funny that the actual in my head, I was like, it's some sort of medical condition. He's contracted. Mm-hmm. He's calling it stank foot. But the fact that it is actually ant bites is
so
the
here's
only
what
thing
happened.
Better than stank foot.
We're riding down the road. Of course, he's barefoot. He jumps out and lands in an ant pile when we get So, but he didn't say nothing to me. Don't say nothing to nobody. He's so hype about being there. He's hugging Lee's neck. He's hugging our buddy Warren, who's an organizer out of Alabama, who's rad. What we were doing was raising money for miners and their families because the miners are on strike. So he's getting so hype. He's meeting the head miner named Carl. What do you say, buddy? That guy's looking at him like, I don't know what to think about this son of a bitch. His red is on 400. He is running through a barbecue with kids everywhere. I'm like, God damn, where are we at? What do I do with my heart? I wish I'd brought my fucking goat. Barefoot.
DJ is like a horse on ketamine all the time.
Yes. He's doing that while ants by him and not like the miner's daddy sister. Yeah.
Right.
So his feet swell up.
Yeah.
So he goes to put his boots back on. He's like, God damn, buddy, my feet too swollen for these ant bites. I don't think I can do it. I guess I'll just be barefoot. So now he's just barefoot all day.
So more ants.
So he's running around barefoot. There's no doubt more ants. Well, dude, the show, I mean, it was put on by the miners and these organizers. They did it as low level as they could. It was just on a horse trailer. And, of course, rednecks, the horse trailers, the metal lasts longer than the wood. If you buy a horse trailer, everybody knows.
And it's hot as fuck.
You got to replace the wood. They replaced it with fucking cross ties, like railroad.
Yeah.
Anybody who's ever carried them, they got creosote on them. I don't know if that's how you say that chemical. It's how my dad pronounced it working for the railroad. It burns your skin.
Yeah, yeah.
DJ gets off stage after doing his set barefoot. Damn, buddy, bottom of my feet burning like a motherfucker. It was hot up there. I'm like, looking. I'm like, DJ, it ain't hot up there. You have chemical burns on your feet.
Ant
right
bites
now.
And chemical burns on his feet. Jesus Christ.
That's a great debut back.
Yeah. So then he puts his shoes back on because he forces them on because he's got chemical burns. And we dance to Lee Baines. And he about blew his knee out. DJ may have tore his ACL dancing to Lee Baines in his boots. And then this is sweet but hilarious. A little kid was there, and Lee came down the crowd doing, you know, fucking kick-ass guitar work.
Rock and roll shit that he does.
And the little kid came right up to him and was like, ah, and he was like 11. DJ just started squalling.
Yeah.
And I had to hold him up.
Yeah.
He felt the spirit. He about lost his shit. Just buddy, I can't believe we get to be here right now.
Yeah.
So that was it. Just sleeping on air mattresses. I tell you what, boys, grateful to be in WellRED.
I have a follow up. Actually, okay. I saw an interesting thing on Twitter that I would like for you to clarify since you were there. This is all I know. And I was going to ask you earlier, I was going to send this to the group thread and I intentionally didn't because I was like, he'll waste the hits and rightfully so. From what I read on Twitter, courtesy of our buddy Slob, shout out Slobberhoes, one of the greatest of all time. Is it true or how much of what I'm about to say is true that a group of socialists got in a fight with another group of socialists because they thought they were the wrong socialists when turns out they was the right socialist. And then it was fine, but like that happened, like there was like an altercation. Because
you are off and it's funnier.
Okay.
Matter depending on how you look at it.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I want to know though.
You're racism, ain't it?
There is racism.
Oh.
Well, actually, let's get into that.
Yeah.
But let me tell a story. There's a group of people who call themselves, I think
it's something with a W.
United World Socialists.
It's something, yeah, it has a W in it.
And according to the people who were down there with these miners trying to organize a strike, they are like the Westboro Baptists of socialists. Mm. The way Westboro Baptist is Christian, these people are socialists. In other words, I mean, yeah, I guess they are, but they're also these other things. Apparently, they had been down there during all this strike, because this strike's been going on for months, trying to tell the miners what to do, talking shit about everybody. They're just real dickheads.
Mm-hmm.
They have this whole thing where, like, they don't even believe in striking or organizing labor because they want everybody to, like, set their companies on fire.
How do they get that message out?
By going around and being dickheads.
Right on. Which is, I guess it's not striking or, I don't know, that's just weird.
So, the word socialist is in their name. Well, these old boys down there who are miners, now they're like on the fucking, you know, the defense of these people coming back, being around. So this benefit happens, and a lot of groups want to come and do their podcast, be a part of it, help raise money. And the guys who organize it are like, yeah, come help us. You put your podcast out saying you're down here, maybe we'll get, because we had online donations. Someone puts up a flag that I think said Democratic Socialists of America. I don't know. It had the word socialist.
Are they fine?
They are fine.
Okay.
But the old boys, you know, the miners, the fucking, you know, Papa Joe's and Uncle Billy's, right, and a man literally known as Grape.
You know why?
Socialist, and they apparently confronted him. Well, somebody asked DJ if we'd do their podcast. DJ said, yes, he comes to get me. I go to meet this guy. I walk up to shake his hand, not knowing. I literally walked into the middle of it.
Oh,
I
God.
Thought he was getting his stuff out. He's putting his stuff up. Well, now Grape thinks I'm on their team. This big old head motherfucker named Grape staring at me like I don't know what's going on. That escalates into a yelling match in which a white man said to a black man, I'll fuck you up, boy.
That ain't it.
Called him boy a couple times.
Do you think that it was truly a, like, I know what I'm doing, or I call everybody boy and I forgot what I'm doing?
In my heart, I think it's both. I think that
he
calls everybody boy and
he knew what he was doing.
Especially black people.
Right.
That's in my heart. But the realm of possibility is everything from he was trying to be awful but get away with it to he just calls young people boy.
Right.
But that happened. I mean, it was bad. Like that was the racial aspect, but they were at each other's throat, calling each other motherfucker and stuff too. And the people that weren't the miners, they left, which good on them. And irrespective of what happened, you know, that was the right move to just get out of there or whatever. And then our buddy Warren, who we met at Atlanta show.
I know Warren.
I'll tell you that story in a minute, but he's one of Lee's friends. He tried to smooth it over. I mean, honestly, dude, like I said, you can look at it one of two ways. You can go, people trying to come together and do good and we still can't all get along.
Right.
Or you can go, yeah, man, fucking red. It got red as hell.
Right.
He's out there with the goat. He was getting bit by ants and fucking, you know, some shit went down.
Yeah, it was a bunch of miners on a horse trailer in Alabama. So some horse trailer Alabama shit happened.
Right.
What are you going to do?
The fact that it happened to one of the three black men there, though, not a big surprise.
Pretty raven, yeah. Well, all right. I'm glad you cleared that up, because I saw it on the thing and I was just like, man, it seemed like it was going to be like a pretty peaceful time.
Well, and they then, left, which, yeah, was, yeah. which was a big, they was very big of them. And yeah, then yeah. it was like everybody kind of refocused on what we were there for.
But you raised a lot of money. You got to hang out with fucking Lee Baines and Cooley.
Yeah.
So, and DJ got bit by ants. So all in all, pretty good.
10 out of 10.
Yeah.
Joe.
Yes.
You have returned to
I have. After it feels like off. I've been gone forever.
And we said before, you know, one of the reasons that you weren't here was because you performed in front of a live audience for the first time in 18 months, weirdly, at the MTV Movie Awards. So,
yeah, isn't that
we
crazy?
Haven't mentioned that. I'm sure all of our listeners know that, and I'm sure they'd like to, you know, hear about it. Also, yeah. just so everybody knows, our my sister will be rejoining us in the latter half of the show, so stay tuned for that redassery. But yeah, Joe, tell us about it.
Yeah, I'd like to get this out of the way. Somebody commented on, somebody posted something on my Twitter, which God, I'm trying to get better about, like just skimming past it. That was just like, you know, Corey hadn't been on the WellRED podcast in 2 weeks because he got too fucking big for the show because of MTV. And at first I thought it was a joke, but then I clicked on their profile to see who it was, and they didn't follow me no more.
Yeah.
So like clearly they were mad. None of that. I mean, well, first off, yes, literally I couldn't do it the week I was on the MTV Movie Awards because I was traveling and it was just an insane week for me. And then as y'all, I know that y'all mentioned, last week was literally because my, and I don't want to talk about this, but I'll just say the reason my dog passed away and it triggered some depression, and I literally just couldn't, I just couldn't fucking do it. So none of that is true. There's no, I mean, I'm physically too big for my britches right now because MTV got me hooked on these cookies called Tate's Cookies. And I cannot quit eating them. I ate an entire box last night by myself with half a gallon of milk. But yeah, man, it's pretty nuts. Like to even say out loud, like took an 18 month break from being on stage in front of a live audience. And then, oh, by the way, your first time is going to be on international television. So yeah, it was fucking crazy, man.
My favorite thing, you're talking about being too big for your britches because of MTV. My personal favorite thing that came out of that experience was MTV, like the official MTV Twitter account, tweeted a gif of you. Are you pulling it up? Look at this. How about that? He's got it right there on the homepage. Look at this gif, everybody.
Yeah,
for people that are listening only, it's Corey dancing and shoving various concession items into his mouth. He's pouring popcorn all over his face, taking it down the top.
How quick was that, by the way?
That, yeah, you had that ready to go.
I did. Yeah. I had a feeling, by the way.
Yeah.
Do you have the other?
Yeah, I got the other. I haven't watched it, though, and I don't want to, frankly.
But what are you talking about?
My actual performance.
Oh, the thing you did. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
okay. I haven't even watched it yet. And it's really weird because like I watch when I do a Buttercream Dream rant and stuff like that, like just a regular one, I always go back and watch them because I'm trying to like go, I don't like that you did. Or, oh, that move was good. I like the inflection of that. Like I'm always kind of studying them. This one, I can't fucking watch it. I don't know why. Like you know what it is? It's because there's an audience. It's because there's a fucking audience. And I'm worried that I'll go, oh, they didn't like that part. You know what I mean?
There's nothing to gain mentally, I don't think. I mean, maybe you could learn some stuff, but it's like, how often are you going to do the MTV Awards?
For sure.
A character, but what you could lose is any positive beliefs.
Exactly. Exactly. To me, it was like, it was perfect. It felt good. It was awesome. It was fun. But if I watched it, I would just, because I can't watch my stand-up clips near as much as I can watch, like, when I'm doing just a character video.
I literally have to be, like, drunk to watch.
Yeah.
To watch myself.
Yeah.
But also especially in front of other people. Like
yeah.
the idea of, I know this didn't even get brought up, but the idea of like us playing that here right now on the show, I would never,
I know I mean,
I would never even ask you to do that. Cause I know if it was me, that would be torturous.
Yeah.
For me. I've been in places where people pull out their phones and like to play videos of mine or something. You know, in a way, like to someone, it's like, oh, you got to see this. It's so great.
It's cool. It's flattering.
It is flattering, but I'm dying.
Oh,
inside,
dude,
the
so
whole
bad.
Time. Like, please don't do this to me, please.
So bad.
Yeah. For the record, I wasn't asking you to play it. I was actually referring to, and I just let it go, but I was actually referring to, do you have the picture from the fashion? What's the word I'm looking for?
Oh, there was when BuzzFeed ranked me the worst dressed at the MTV Movie Awards. And then, and by the way, they didn't come out and say worst dressed, but it was 1 through 12 and I was 12. So, I mean, and the one, there was one from Australia. No, I don't have those pictures, but one from Australia, which they didn't say it was bad. They just said they were like, it's a lot going on here. You know, like, look at it. And so I thought that was pretty cool. Like, just, it was really cool for me. Like, of course, like, it's a comedy character. I don't care. But, like, I do think there was a little bit of, like, y'all are critiquing a movie that you haven't even seen because, like, y'all don't know. You know what I mean? It, like, in the context
it's,
of me,
it's like Mark said in the group chat when you were sharing with us all these various sources.
People tell me I don't hit.
Didn't hit in terms of how you were dressed.
Including your own awards.
Mark said he was like, that's fucking stupid though, because like this is all like red carpet attire, you right. know, like that's a thing. That's a thing with these award shows. Who wore what? Who wore who? Who wore it best? Whatever right. that whole thing. It's like red carpet fashion. And they included you in that, but that you weren't doing that.
Right.
You,
exactly.
You were doing a character.
Yeah. I was doing different. What the buttercream dream would do in that situation, which is insane.
Right. And but that, like, but to judge well, you by that standard,
it's crazy.
You weren't playing the same game as everybody
exactly.
else is fucking stupid.
I agree.
It's funny, though.
It's real funny, and I'm glad it happened.
I'm furious that they didn't put you in black slacks. I don't know why, but I just feel like that would have made everything better.
I had them, and they had me between white and black, and my Jeannie, who was my costume designer, she really liked the way that the red belt popped. And I just went with it. And to me also, I was like, this kind of looks like Elvis-y, like, you know, late, like right before he died. But like,
Elvis.
Yeah. But like, it was cool. Cause like, you know, I don't know if I told you this, dude, the fucking, she custom made like my shirt. Those yeah. are fucking, and I got to take it home. Those are real Swarovski. I don't know how you pronounce it. Swarovski fucking crystals on that shit. Nice. Like that shirt is expensive as fuck, son.
Well, I understand why they went with white. It came across on screen as khakis.
Yeah.
And I thought that was hilarious. Honestly, right. I thought, well, that's funny. That's right. The funniest fucking thing. And oh, what a pair of khakis.
Yeah, yeah. No, I know. That could, like, just me. I look like I'm about to go to, like, a post golf tournament dinner or something. And I'm like,
the costume lady. That's on the lighting people. They lit your pants incorrectly.
I agree with you. But that whole, the red carpet, by the way, that's a wild thing. That's not at all what you think it would be. You don't really do a lot of walking. You know what I mean? Like you get there and there's like all these stations and you slide over to them and they take your picture. Then you slide over and they talk to you. But at no point are you just kind of like walking. You know what I mean? Like, oh, like it's really bizarre. And maybe now granted, it's like, maybe that was a different red carpet situation, but this was like supposed to be the first red carpet back from COVID. Like they didn't do one at the Oscars. So everybody's like, oh, it's the first one. But like, it was like a square and you just went to these, like, here, this person will take your picture. All right, they're done. Slide over. So like, I don't know. That didn't hit for me.
Do you think that it was done differently than
maybe
pre-COVID? Also, was it, I know it's two completely different levels of things, but do you remember when we did the red carpet at that?
Oh, at Dollywood. Dollywood. Do you know what though?
On hilarious.
That, in that, like, situation, we did walk a little bit.
We
that
walked.
Hit,
we
that
like
hit for me harder.
Up and walked up a carpet.
I like people. That one better.
And then you stopped in front of the thing and people took the pictures
yeah.
and shit.
This will come as a shock to no one. I like the one at Dollywood better.
but I wonder if it's like, I wonder if it's not like markedly different.
Right.
This year than it normally
yeah,
would be.
Yeah, it probably, like, obviously.
Just because of COVID and everything, you know.
Right.
I feel like everything's at least a little bit different.
Yeah, for sure.
But it sounds like you're saying, Corey, that it's tighter, not more spread out.
Yeah, it was tight.
It
now, they were behind a fence and all the people
I was
interviewing.
Say, my
they had
allowed to control everything better by like isolating it into
yeah.
one area that you sort of come in and out of as opposed to like a big.
And we were all, you know, like everybody there had been vaccinated and tested like three goddamn times, so like it was pretty safe. But like the reporters and stuff were wearing masks and also a face shield. There was this one girl that she was asking me stuff and I just went, yep, like I don't know what the fuck she was saying and I didn't want to look stupid, so she literally could have been like, so are you a Nazi? And I'd be like, yeah, right on.
I didn't want to look stupid, yeah. So I kept saying yes.
Yeah.
That's right. doing the finger
that's
gun.
Like
you
got it. Pew, pew,
that's pew, right, pew. Baby.
That's the Joe distilled down.
Just yeah.
I didn't want to be stupid, so I just agreed. Yeah. But it was fucking wild, man. Like I had, you know, like we talk about it all the time. Like we got complete imposter syndrome. Like, man, it was on, like it was full effect at this thing. Like, because dude, yeah. like I was like, yeah, I'm doing the MTV Movie Awards. Let you know, Leslie's gonna have me out there to be wherever. And then it kept saying, I was like, she's the host. So like, this is a big deal. Then I get there and I'm like, yeah, but like they'll have me kind of put off to the side. My fucking trailer was right beside Captain America's. And I was like, what? And like the whole time I was sitting in my trailer, I was just like, that thought we always have is like, all right, at some point, someone's going to walk in here and go, we've made a huge mistake. We're so sorry, but you've got to go. And it never happened. And everybody treated me so great. And like, I know that's because like they thought I was talent, you know, but like, but it was fucking nuts, man. Like Snoop Dogg called me Youngblood or some shit. Like it was kind of crazy. He laughed. Like it was fucking wild, man. Like just what a.
He didn't get to know you long enough to know about your blood. You got old blood.
That's true. Really cool. Yeah, my blood don't hit, but like
thick blood. What's up, thick blood?
That's my fucking blood. But yeah, man.
Smell like a weed.
I mean, I didn't get that close to him because he was behind his DJ thing, and then I just kind of walked off, and I just made like I had it in my mind. I was like, if he comes up to you and wants to talk, cool, but like that's it because the last thing I need. Is for to find out I don't hit for him, but he laughed at my shit, smiled at me, and was just like, "What up, young blood?" or some shit. By the way, it's probably racist for me to assume that's what it was. It was just it looked like that's what he said, and I've heard Snoop Dogg say that before, so I'm pretending in my brain that that's what it was that he said. So there you go. I'm canceled.
Great job, young man. He called me young blood.
Wow, lad, that was a phenomenal performance, fellow.
Hey, you just reminded me of a question I wanted to ask y'all. When you were texting us this, I thought of this. The Snoop Dogg DJ?
Or yeah, is that DJ like Snoopadelic.
Okay. I didn't know if – I thought maybe it was one of those where it was like, hey, you do rap and you're black. Stand behind the DJ booth. Can like they farm? Handed you a banjo, you know?
Yeah. I saw that there was a DJ called DJ Snoopadelic, and in my brain I was like, huh, I wonder if this guy gets in trouble for like going having Snoop in his name. Like that's wild. And then I looked up and it's like, and that's when I texted y'all. I was like, y'all, it's really Snoop Dogg. And that's just like when he's rapping, he's Snoop Dogg. When he's DJing, he's DJ Snoopadelic. And when he's doing that other shit, he's Snoop Lion.
Reggae type shit.
Reggae type shit. So like, no, he DJs, and for the rehearsal at least, he was just playing his own shit, which I thought was awesome.
Well, especially because he's such an OG and everything.
Yeah, all his stuff is.
I think I would see DJ Snoopadelic and assume it was like a little Nas X situation, meaning like...
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Some kid who, you know...
Loves Snoop.
Dog and named themselves an homage to
that's
him.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, right.
And turns out I could see that. It was the thing that hit harder.
Yeah, much harder.
I bet he would be cool with it if a young kid did that.
I think so too.
Cool. And then for two, because he took his name from a cartoon character.
Right. That's true.
It's funny. No one ever thinks about that way because he's been Snoop for so long and you just take it for granted.
You don't think of Snoopy Dog,
You don't think of Snoopy at all. The
weirder one to me that it gets mentioned in passing every now and then when somebody's like, the Yo MTV Raps Dr. Dre, not that Dr. Dre. It's like, what a specific name for one of them who clearly knew that this dude was named Dr. Dre to be like, I'll just be Dr. Dre too. Like, that's fucking weird. You know what I mean? Like, huh?
Well, do you think, I mean, they both were like around in the day. I'm sure like the big Dr. Dre predates the large Dr. Dre.
He was on Yo MTV Raps before.
Dr. Dre, the famous Dr. Dre, probably definitely around and active and doing shit for a long time. I don't know who predates who, but I think it's very possible that they each independently
was parallel thinking, and then they were like, fuck it, I'm not changing.
Dr. Dre, I feel like at a certain point had to be the one that was like,
just like, hey, well, he hits harder than me.
You have to admit that,
of course.
At that point, you're like, I ain't fucking changing. Fuck that.
Right.
And,
Michael Bolton on Office Space.
Why would I change?
My name.
He's the one that sucks.
But you can't say that about Dr. Dre. You know what I mean? Like, you can't front. He hits.
But
it's making me think that doctor must have been a thing, like MC.
Yeah,
I would say that's what I was gonna say.
Other doctors,
I was gonna say that, but before I did, I started
like in wrestling, there's a bunch of kings.
I started thinking, and I was like, I can't think of any other, but I thought the same thing. I was like, oh, well, that was just it's two guys named Andre or Dre, and you know, doctor was like the lil of its time. But then I started thinking about it, and I was like, I can't think of no other doctors, though.
Yeah, why didn't they do like lawyer Dre?
There was the DOC, rest in peace,
absolutely.
Speaking of doctor stuff, well, I don't know how much actually they probably don't want me to say there's anything doctor related to this, but it does hit CBD.
It does hit.
We're big fans, big proponents of it here on the show. As soon as I was just trying to do my cute little segue, we've been talking about doctors, rap doctors. And then as soon as I said that, I was like, oh, I don't need to be acting like we doctors on here when we talk about CBD. But
10 out of 10 rap doctors agree.
Rap doctors, 9 out of 10 rap doctors agree CBD hits.
That's it.
So y'all know that CBD hits for us here on the show. We're talking about Caliper CBD. Big fans of it. We like what they're about. And, you know, if you want to feel more calm, you want to deal with your stress, if you got pain, you got soreness, you want to sleep easier, I like to use it for my belly, then Caliper CBD is for you. The thing that makes Caliper stand out is that it is a dissolvable powder that comes in these little single serving packets, and you just dump it into whatever you're hitting with and make it hit that
make
way.
Make it hit even harder. There,
make it hit. It's the only Caliper CBD powder is the only clinically proven fast acting CBD. Caliper delivers 30 times more CBD in the first 30 minutes versus CBD oil. You get all the benefits of CBD in just 10 minutes, whereas some oils can take over an hour to
get
fully
get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, over an hour. Ain't nobody got time for that. It was developed by food science experts with decades of experience, rigorously tested for purity and quality. Caliper CBD comes in convenient and easy to use packs. There's precisely 20 milligrams in each packet, always THC free. Feel better without the high. No weird taste, no oily residue. Mixes easily into any food or drink. It's all natural, vegan, non-GMO, free of any fillers, free of any added chemicals, free of any artificial flavors. Caliper CBD, it hits. So get 20% off your first order when you use the promo code WellRED. That's WellRED at trycaliper.com/WellRED. You can try Caliper CBD risk-free for 30 days. If you don't love it, they will give you a full refund. Refund in full. That's trycaliper.com/WellRED. Don't forget the promo code WellRED for 20% off your first order. And we thank them for sponsoring the podcast.
Oh, I'm sorry, Trae. I was barely paying attention to you there at the end because I was looking at my new trap phone that I got to go with my new plan from Mint Mobile. After years of fine print contracts and getting ripped off by big wireless providers, if we've learned anything, it's that there's always a catch. So when I first heard that Mint Mobile offers premium wireless service starting at just $15 a month, I thought, shut the fuck up, you liar. Turns out, not at all. No catch. But after speaking with them, using their service, it all made sense. There isn't one. No catch. Mint Mobile's secret sauce is that they're the first company to sell wireless service online only by cutting out retail stores. There's no crazy overhead costs that get passed down to you in the form of mystery fees like the goddamn rust-proofing of the mobile phone world. Instead, Mint just passes on sweet savings directly to you. So here's what I did. Our friends over at Mint Mobile were like, look, Corey, we're going to send you SIM card to put in. And I was like, well, you know what? Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to keep my other service because, you know, that's just people know me by that number and all my buddies. I said, but can we just do a new phone? And I'm going to like compare the two. I think that'll be the coolest thing. So I have one of the leading providers. I have just as good, if not, hell, right now at the beach, I got better service with Mint Mobile. It's tremendous. I love it. So for people, look, and I got a trap phone. Who doesn't love a trap phone? Here's the difference. I don't have any hoes, but this is where I keep my Domino's app. You know what I mean? I put my Domino's app on this phone. For people looking for extra savings, Mint Mobile offers premium wireless for just $15 a month. All plans come with unlimited talk and text, plus high-speed data. And I promise you, that shit's great on the nation's largest 5G network. Use your own phone with any Mint Mobile plan and keep your same phone number along with all your existing contacts. If you're not 100% satisfied Mint Mobile has you covered with their 7-day money-back guarantee. Switch to Mint Mobile and get premium wireless service starting at just $15 a month. To get your wireless plan, all you got to do for $15 a month, get the plan shipped to your door for free. Go to mintmobile.com/wellred. That's mintmobile.com/wellred. Cut your wireless bill to $15 a month. That's 3 fucking cups of coffee at mintmobile.com/wellred. Your boy the Cho's doing it. Be like me.
Yes, be like the Cho. I don't have a transition, guys. I'm just ready to talk about sleeping. We've been talking about these Helix sleep mattresses for the past few weeks, but I got to tell you, this weekend was the first time I went away from it. And when I got back to it, I was so excited to be back to it. Maybe you're just having trouble sleeping lately because of politics or the pandemic or your love life, or maybe because you're on the road sleeping on an air mattress and you smell like a goat and DJ keeps rubbing his fucking stank foot all over you. Whatever it is that's going on in your life that's making it hard to sleep down there in Alabama with no air conditioning, if you order a Helix, when you get back to that Helix, let me tell you something. You're going to sleep like a Bailey. Baby, the way Helix works is that you take
like a Bailey pill, too.
Bailey, baby, crazy, ladies, all of them sleep good on a Helix, all right? You take a quiz at helix.com. It takes 2 minutes to complete the quiz. It matches your body type and sleep preferences, and they find the mattress for you. That was one thing that I liked about it. I didn't know what kind of mattress I needed, hard, firm, soft. This is like choosing between my favorite kind of woman. I don't know. They told me what I wanted. You know what I mean? So everyone's unique. Helix knows that, and they're going to give you several mattress models to choose from. I love it. I get on it. I sleep like a baby. Andy gets mad at me. She says, you're sleeping better without me. I say, is it because you're not here or is it because of this Helix? I think it's the Helix because they want me to say that, and Andy would murder me if I said otherwise. So go to helix.com/wellred. Take that 2-minute sleep quiz and they will match you with a customized mattress to give you the best sleep of your life. You get a 10-year warranty. You can try it out for 100 nights risk-free, and they'll pick it up for you if you hate it. But you're going to love it, I promise. So they're offering $200 off mattress orders and 2 free pillows for our listeners at helix.com/wellred. So go to helix.com/wellred for up to $200 off and 2 free pillows. Guys, it's time to replace your mattress.
It is time to replace your mattress. Do that. And it's also time to replace what we were talking about on the show and bring in our special guest. You know her from, being Trae's fucking sister and being on the show before. And she's here to talk about what the fuck is it? What's it?
Start
Paige,
your video,
unmute
girl.
Yourself.
Yeah, it's Paige Crowder, everybody. Lil Sissy. Is she here? I don't
see
her.
She's
oh,
there she
hello.
Is. Hi.
Look how pretty. Hello.
Oh,
you're glowing.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
First of all, I miss y'all so much.
Miss you.
Yeah. Hold on. Taylor's being ridiculous right now. She won't stop crying, so I'm probably going to have to hold her in my lap.
That's fine. Cool. I'm sure people will be totally fine with that.
Yeah.
How you feeling?
Pregnant.
Yeah. What does that mean?
Damn.
Look at that. Oh, my goodness.
That's what Trae. You look even more like Trae now.
Look at that thing.
God damn, girl.
That's a big one.
That's a big baby.
He's so big. I'm only 20 weeks. But he's so big. He measures like his weight is like 96th percentile, and his femurs are greater than 95th because you know his daddy's 6'6".
Yeah,
so
they measure femurs. Boy,
I know, right? That's
God
what Katie
damn.
Said.
That sounds
hey,
wild.
Us this breakdown.
Top of monkey.
She sent us this this screenshot of a breakdown of all her baby's specs. You know, spec sheet for her baby. And Katie was like, I don't think I got none of that shit. I certainly don't remember them measuring femurs.
Well, that's what everybody that I've showed that to said. So I think it's just something to do with like high risk.
You just go around talking about the baby's femurs to everybody. Everybody's like, how do you
what
know about his femurs? What?
Yeah, that's literally everybody. They're like, I never got anything about that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Well.
Hey,
didn't you have something you wanted to talk about specifically?
Yes. Well, first of all, Corey,
Paige.
What about being on the MTV Awards?
I know. Wasn't that crazy?
I mean, I know that's like old news by now, but I'm not
going to. No, we were literally
just talking.
Cause this is the first episode Corey's been back on the show since that happened. So we were just talking about it. So you good?
Well, how neat is that?
God, it's so crazy. You haven't even had the baby yet, but you're already talking like a Southern mama.
Because I said neat.
How neat is that? It was neat. It was real neat. Did you watch the MTV Awards for the first time in your life because of that?
Well, actually, I thought this was the very first for TV and movie, the very first MTV TV and movie awards.
Oh, is it? Oh, was it?
TV, she's saying they include, all they did was rope TV into.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I remember me and Daddy used to watch the MTV Movie Awards every year, like religiously.
By the way, I've since talked to people who are with you. They were like, yeah, dude, we watched it all the time. I guess it was just me that didn't.
Yeah, isn't it like the best kiss? Isn't that when Britney and Christina and Madonna all kissed?
Oh, was that that? Oh, I watched that. Dude,
there's so many huge cultural moments that are happening. From the MTV.
Maybe I did watch it.
It used to be a massive thing.
Music and Movie Awards?
Yes. The Britney and Madonna, that actually might have been the VMAs, but they both were huge. The VMAs and the Movie Awards were both, because MTV was the shit.
No, it was definitely Movie Awards because it was the best kiss category.
Yep.
Oh, right.
Well, you know what? I know for a fact I've watched at least once because I watched the year that Tobey Maguire and Kirsten Dunst won it for Spider-Man. Okay. You know what? I did. You know what it is, man? You know what it fucking is? I have done a lot of pills.
And I was going to say drugs. I cut you off.
There's just a lot. Yeah, there's just a lot that I'm just like, I don't think I did that. But like, yeah, I sure did. All right. Hell.
Well, anyway, yeah. I'm not going to lie. I watched it till your part.
Yeah.
And I turned it.
Well, for the record, me too.
Okay.
No, I'm just kidding. I mean, I went back in my trailer and watched the rest of it.
But I was so proud. I was like, I took like a bunch of pictures of you and then posted it on my Instagram, and I never post on my Instagram story. And then when Leslie skewed.
It was great, wasn't it? That was her idea.
I loved it.
Yeah, that was like 100% her idea. It was pretty wild. That was a great moment. It was a great moment for the South, son. Great moment for the word skew. Great moment for the brand, you know. But that was all Leslie. And that's where I was like, what if I hand you the belt? And so now I think in kayfabe, I have to get another belt because Leslie's the European champion now. Yeah, like I believe that. Like I'm committed to this. So like I told Amber, I was like, I know it's $1,800, but what the fuck do you want me to do?
I knew that's where this was going. I believe it's in my heart. At least that's what I told my wife when I bought that fucking belt.
So yeah, it was cool, but it's good to see you, Paige.
Well, so speaking of wrestling or champs, whatever, this isn't exactly wrestling, but it's kind of like a SmackDown. So I made that post on Trey's birthday, and it had the screenshot of me texting him and saying how like I'll just randomly picture this dude's hand or head and his hand smashed against the floor. I mean, y'all know this story.
I don't know that I do, but our audience doesn't know it.
But it's never been told on the podcast, I'm pretty sure. So, I mean,
because I had wrote about it.
Oh, I know this. Yep, tell it.
Yeah, but I don't think it's ever been talked about on here. But so I posted it, and then when I posted it, everybody's like, I've got to know what this is talking about. So I thought I would just let everybody know what it was about real
Please.
Quick. So when I was in junior high, Trae was already in high school.
Oh,
I know why Trae. If I was Trae, I'd definitely want this story told.
Well, so
it was her idea for the record.
No, I know, but I'm just saying I would have been like, yeah, goddamn right. Tell this story. Let them know what's up.
Well, so there was these two boys that were just meaner than hell. Like, they just stayed picking on us girls. Like, we literally, like, pull our pants down, like, every single day. Like, you had to have them. And I know that, like, was a thing to get your shorts pulled down or whatever.
Yeah.
But, like, I mean, you know what I mean. anyway, so
yeah, the past when we used to just pull girls' pants down, it was a more innocent time. Jesus Christ.
Well, no, I know. That's the thing is when I think about it, I'm like, boys don't really act like in Salina, like it didn't become inappropriate for boys and girls to fight until like. I'm not joking.
When did you say it happened? When did you say it finally happened?
What, when it becomes inappropriate?
Yeah.
What goddamn Obama administration. What
around
do you think?
Like age 16 or 17.
I thought you meant like 2012.
We all did. There was a citywide proclamation.
Yeah, right.
No, like it was until.
So still to this day, under the age of 16 in Salina.
Ding, ding, ding.
I mean, things may have changed by now, but like, and remember,
I wonder all the time whether things have changed.
If kids are whooping each other's asses across all genders.
All the old crazy, like, fucking redneck ass Salina shit. I wonder all the time, like, if it still be that way or not.
Do you remember, like, swapping licks, like, where you would just, like, punch each other in the arm as hard as you could to see, like, how long you could take it? Like,
fucking passing out game.
The
craziest one.
You know who did that? Our fucking teacher.
Your teacher did it too.
he would fucking knock us out all the time.
Was he a coach?
Yeah, and he ain't no more.
Of course he was.
Yeah. We did that in Spanish class, and our immigrant Spanish teacher literally thought we were worshiping the devil because, you know, when you pass out, you start doing weird shit.
Yeah. Our buddy Nathan, who is like, this was the worst person for this to happen to, because, you know, he was not the
real dumb.
Yeah, a little bit. And we were all fucking passing each other out in like the high school library.
That boy's brain needs all the oxygen it can get.
Right, yeah, exactly. And when he passed out, dude, he like dead weight straight down, alligator arms, was like, it looked like he was having a seizure for me. Yeah. And that was the first time. It's so funny because there should have been so many times before that, but that was the first time we were like, hey, y'all, he's a little fucked up, maybe. Like,
yeah, man.
Like, up until that moment, it's like, no, it's cool. Yeah. It's so stupid.
So dumb, man.
The third guy we did it to, I never did it. And that's why I saw a guy do that and I was like, that'll kill me, y'all.
In my recollection, I definitely tried to have it done to me, but I pussed out and tapped to her. Like, I don't think I ever went out. I must have, like,
I think that's because we're more evolved.
Then Drew, but it's so funny though, because like, it's funny that Drew, like, you made the right decision in doing that, but then you went straight to practice and got targeted during Oklahoma drills fucking 19 times in a row. And it's like, oh yeah, at least I didn't get passed out.
Fucking dove into a 300 pounder.
Right. That's what I'm saying. Like, but again, you didn't know.
I've never admitted it, but I did that like quite a few times. Not quite a few, but like I'd say probably like four or five.
Passed out.
Yeah. The two things that got me.
I've done whippets. You don't have to be ashamed.
Is one time, like I was like kind of passed out, but I wasn't like fully passed out, and then like so I wasn't passed out until. My cousin was like backed away from me, and then all of a sudden
that sentence could be isolated and be hilarious.
Tipped over and hit my face on the corner of a table because she thought I was not passed out, and like my whole ear was like bruised and fucked up. So like that done me. And two, we had a situation where we helped a girl pass out, and she pulled a Nathan Blakely. It was actually somebody in your grade, but I'm not gonna tell who it was, but. So she like we was like smacking her in the face trying to get her to wake up, and so yeah, that done me. Yeah, I've never told anybody that I did it, but now knowing that y'all all did it too, then
everybody did it
all the time. We was kids.
Yeah, I was more ashamed of the fact that I didn't do it.
Yeah, for sure, pussy.
Well, you're like, oh, it must have been we were more evolved. I'm like, shut up. But anyway, so those boys, like.
Oh, yeah.
Like, didn't care. Like, they really, like, physically hit me and stuff. And, like, well, actually, I remember this one time. He ran up and jumped on his friend's back and kicked me in the. what word should I
pussy,
use?
Pussy, head,
cooter.
Cooter. Yeah. Pussy head.
In the cooch or whatever.
Like gave you a sniz kick. We get it.
Like as hard as he could.
Yeah.
And
just to see if you're like, dude, I bet it don't hurt him because I ain't got balls.
Oh, no, he was trying to hurt me. He was a little fuckhead. And then, like, so, and then not only would they, like, pull our pants down when we was outside, they would grab, there was a picnic table. Trae, you remember the picnic tables outside of the gym that everybody sat on. And we would sit on the picnic tables, and they would come up and grab our legs and drag us down the hill below it. Like, just mean as hell. And, like they, one of them was pretty big too. So like he was always the thing that kept me from just knocking the fuck out of the little skinny one. Cause he would always be standing behind him and like, you know, but anyway, so one day in class, I still remember what started it. What, he kept, so my friend had like pimples on her forehead and she would like pick them. And so they were like scabs or whatever.
I mean, she deserved to get pushed off a bench. That's gross.
You stop that.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm like, don't make me send Trae after you for talking about my friend.
I ain't gonna do shit.
And so, and she was like my best friend, and she was like Trae's little sister too. But anyway, none of that even matters. She, I remember him saying something like, "Ooh, she has herpes," and like just kept saying she had herpes all over her face.
Classic.
And the thing is this boy was. Eat up with ugly. Like,
he really was, man.
Really?
He was rough.
You don't say.
Yeah.
The angry little shit.
And he had
Salina, Tennessee. Didn't hit.
Trash goose, man.
Really? And he had the worst acne and blackheads I've ever seen in my life. And that just, and he just stayed on her just to be a little asshole. And she was so self-conscious about it. So he was like saying that to her one day. So I was like, well, if having pimple or having herpes is having pimples on your face, then you're eat up with them. And boy, that just set him off, I guess, because I walked
the truth.
Yeah, that's the thing. It's like, anyway, that don't even matter. I don't know why I'm even caring, thinking about it, because I ain't seen this kid in years. And he's nicer now, whatever. And I think he apologized to me, but whatever. Anyway. So I was walking to my locker and like wasn't paying attention at all. And he ran up behind me and like pushed me as hard as he could face first into my locker. And I turned around and I was like about to fight him. And of course he had the other dude standing right behind him. So, you know, we just did the whole nose to nose thing or whatever. And so like these little boys were also very racist.
Really? That's surprising. I can't believe that.
Yeah. And so they use the N-word a lot. And I don't know if it was at that point or if I'd said it to them before, but like I told them, like, if they didn't stop, I was going to get my brother on them. Mm-hmm. And they, you know how I am about somebody talking about my bubby. Like, that's my one thing. Like, you don't go for my brother. Or
can
like,
I guess what they said?
It's exact as I recall.
What's that fucking queer gonna do?
Yes, pretty much.
One of them. It was either
pretty much.
Or N-word lover.
Yeah. But
he was friends with.
That's a good one.
He was friends with the black boy. Like there wasn't a lot of black people in our school, but the there was a black girl in my grade, and her older brother was in Trae's grade, and they
know Skybone.
Skybone, yeah.
Yeah.
So they just started throwing David Allen Coe B-sides at you, just here and there and everywhere.
Loved David Allen Coe. They did. but anyway, so they was like, they said, all that pussy ain't gonna do nothing, that N-word lover, just like, because he was friends with black people or whatever. So, and said that he tried to act black because he didn't wear Wranglers and boots or something like that.
The backwards FUBU jersey was a bit much, but you know.
Anyway, so that day when I got home, like, and not to sound obvious, like school shootings and like, and that kind of, listen, obviously that stuff is insane and those people are insane.
Yeah.
But I can almost see how being bullied and terrorized and stuff can push a kid to lose their shit.
Right. Well, they're that's a symptom of a larger thing. But I get it.
Because that day when I got home, I'm there and smart enough to know not to take anything to school that can ruin my life and be considered a weapon. But I was going through Trey's room looking for something that was big enough to not be considered a weapon, but that I could take and knock him plumb out with it.
Yeah.
And I still remember what I found. It was
a lead pipe
trophy.
What did you say?
A math trophy. I really did have a whole bunch of academic awards in my room.
What's the book? The thing.
No athletic ones. Up. What?
Bookend.
Like the way. The glass things that you said at
bookend.
The end. Yeah, a bookend, yeah. But I don't remember what you're talking about. That I held my CDs up with?
Yes. Something.
Okay. There,
and that's what I was going to take. And you came in your room and you're like, what the fuck are you doing? And I'm like, I just lost it. I'm like, I can't take it anymore. I'm like, I'm going to knock the fuck out of him tomorrow. And you're like, what is wrong with you? And I told you everything that had been happening. And I told you about like how racist they was and the stuff they said. So, of course, you immediately got on the phone and called Sky. And then you was like, I'm going to take care of this. And so your plan was to just go. Okay, so Trae was in high school and I was still at the K-8.
Yeah.
So he would like drop me off for school in the morning and then go to the high school.
Right.
So he dropped me off and he was like, I'm gonna let you out and then I'm gonna go park and I'm gonna. So my first teacher of the day was one of his favorite teachers and he was like, I'm just gonna come back in and go into your class and ask her if I can have a word, which now I'm like, that would never happen.
Of course not. They would never let that happen. That was a stupid plan.
He was like, I'm just gonna ask if I can have a talk with these boys or with the class.
Right. God, Trey's gonna try to teach again.
Yeah.
Yeah, let them know they better stop.
We'll have a talk with these boys. Oh, about math. No, not
no.
Not
at
all. Well, that morning when I came in, those little punks had already started fucking with me as soon as I walked in the door. And I was just, and all my friends are like, is Trae here? Is Trae here today? And I was just like sitting on the bleachers and I'm like, yeah, keep talking your shit. You know, I'm like, you're about to find out, you know? And
I'm sure you weren't smoking, but I just saw you.
Yeah. For sure. She was smoking.
I'll tell you another guy.
Yeah.
And then they started in with calling him a queer and saying like they would stomp his little pussy ass and all this other
queer pussy ass, maybe.
They seem cool. Like I
don't know for sure.
And I'm just like, keep on talking about my bubby. Keep on then that's why I started losing it and everything. So by the time Trae walks in the front door of the school, I'm like coming out of the gym crying, pissed off. And like he looked over and I said, Bubby, they've already started. And and y'all, I swear, like, so the junior high kids used to go in the gym in the morning. And then when the bell would ring, everybody would come out of the gym and walk down the 7th and 8th grade hall, which was like right where you come in the main doors. So Trae had just walked in and saw me or whatever. And he just like gauged in and just like took off running like as fast as he could down. He saw
how fast is that, by the way,
you know?
Yeah, right.
But and so
not as bad as you think, but right. I mean not great.
Yeah. right.
But so he saw those two boys at the end of the hall, and the big one that was like acting so tough saw him, his eyes got huge, and he turned around and ran the other way and ran back in the classroom. The other one was like walking out to go to the bathroom and like didn't see him yet. And then he looked up and saw him. But by that point, Trae was already in the air. I swear, he like leaped, like he ran as fast as he could and then just like dove through the air and tackled that kid. And I'm not gonna lie, his face like boomed off the wall, and then he like fell to the floor, and then Trae got on top of him, and he like, I just remember him having like his whole head in his hand, and he was like, kicking his head up. I mean, I ain't trying to get Trae in trouble or anything, so
that's
I don't
statute of limitations on beating up an eighth grader is like
8 years. Yeah, I'm about to say. Also, you're allowed to abuse Appalachians. Yeah, it's fine.
He was smart enough. He didn't actually hit him, but he.
I slammed his head into the ground.
Yeah.
A couple of times. It was pretty violent.
Yeah.
And he was like right in his face, too. And he's like, don't you ever, ever touch my sister again, or I will miss you like and I was acting so like everybody else in the hall, like all the girls that had been getting picked on forever were like cheering and like so happy, like this was like the best day ever, but nobody really said anything at this point because everybody was just like holy fuck. And and then of course once the teachers like started coming for Trae, but everybody loved Trae and everybody hated this little punk. So, like, they were just like, Trae, stop, you know? But, of course, I was like, don't fucking touch my bummy. Leave my bummy. Like, acting so stupid, just screaming in the background. And then they took him to the office, but they didn't know what to do because they're like, we don't know how to handle this because we've never had this happen before.
Public outcry is so in your favor.
Yeah, that too. So, first of all, one part that either you didn't see or you don't remember that's seared into my memory is when they finally, it was one of my football coaches, one of the high school football coaches who was a teacher at the junior high, Coach Maxfield, was like, he was the one who like put his hand on my shoulder and was like, hey, like he looked freaked out, not like scared of me, but like, holy shit, this is some wild shit that's happening.
Things okay at home?
Yeah. Yeah. he was like, hey, you all right, you know, to me, yeah. Not the brutalized eighth grader.
Not the kid bleeding in the bathroom.
Yeah, right, yeah. And he was like, all right, well, you know, let's go. And so I just stood up and I just started walking with him to the office. And in my memory, I can remember Paige being sort of hysterical and shit, but I also remember every other kid in the school was just standing stone still, just staring at me. Of course they were, but I'm saying that none of them were saying or doing anything. They were just looking at me like, holy shit, as they marched me down the hallway. And right there in the middle of all those kids, like by where I was walking was Ceci, Skybone's little sister. And as I walked by her, she just goes.
Yes, I do remember that. I was about to
but ask. Yeah, then I got, because you know, I was the smart kid and a good kid and everything. I never got in no trouble. I made straight A's, all that shit. So like at first they were literally just gonna let me get away with it,
of course,
with going to the fucking K-8 and whipping an eighth grader's ass as a high schooler. Cause they were like, what the hell? Cause I never done that like that before. And I've told them what had happened. I was like, he was literally hitting my little sister and pushing her into lockers.
Yeah. Fuck that.
Like calling Sky and Ceci and everybody N word and all this shit every single day, you know? And I told them all that. And they were just like the principal, the vice, everybody. I told them that. And they were like, oh, well, all right then.
Yeah. Don't start no shit, won't be no shit. Yeah, you know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
Hope you didn't get herpes on your knuckles.
Yeah. But then that kid's dad threw a fucking
herpes fit. Senior.
Damn.
Yeah. He called the school and threw a fit or whatever. And was like threatening to sue him or some shit if they didn't punish me. So I got like, I think it was like 6 weeks of detention or something.
It was a lot, but
it was a lot. Yeah,
I can see from that parent's perspective, whatever bullshit story little herpes told him.
Right,
right.
Like we've had arguments before. She's mad at me, but you know, whatever. And then this dude came and beat me up.
Well, no, his dad ended up coming to the office, and I was like, you don't want to try to do that because I had got like all the girls that he had done stuff to, because they was like, we didn't know this was happening. I'm like, no, the teachers absolutely did, because this has been nonstop. I'm like, and if you want to keep on with this, like, it's not just me saying this. I have like 10 other girls that are ready to stand up against him and say what he's been doing to us. So his dad kind of just dropped it, but I did feel so bad. Yeah. I had detention for so long.
Paige hit him with the witness list.
I heard that.
Coming well, through with the accusation here.
Paige, so this all started with her saying she posted a screenshot of some text between us about this recently. She texted me about this story. Like, I was just thinking about this story, whatever. And I told her, which is true. What's funny about that is, so this was, Jesus, what, I mean, fucking almost 20 years ago or something like that.
Yeah.
A long, long time ago. And when she brought it up, it was kind of a Bader Meinhof thing for me because I had just also thought about it literally the day before. And the reason that I thought about it was because DMX had died and I was listening to so much DMX, and there's a line in Bring Your Whole Crew where he goes, how much shit can you talk with your lips on the floor?
Yeah.
And I was listening to that.
You were thinking about curb stomping an eighth grader.
Yes, exactly. Yes. Lifting weights, feeling hard and grieving, you know, over the death of the dog and everything. And then at that lyric, that like flashbulb memory popped in my just seeing that little pump bitch's face on the floor of the K8. And then and I hadn't thought about that in forever. And then the next day, Paige was texting me about it. So that was funny too.
I know that the big guy ran away, but it is hilarious that the littlest one got all the
guff. Yeah, I swear to God, that is because he is the one that I saw. I remembered. I walked in, I saw Paige came up to me crying. She hadn't been in there 90 seconds, and she was already crying and shit. And I just started looking around, and then I just saw the little one, and I just went for it. I never even saw the big fat one. He was big and fat, like, for his age, but I was a junior.
You were one puberty away from
me. Yeah, right. Exactly. So, Paige, listen, we're at time, but you wanted to raise awareness, right? That's the reason you came on here primarily.
Yes. So
let's do that.
That's why I'm wearing my zebra stuff today. Because it's.
Oh. Pretty popular print amongst our people. I'm just saying that was.
Well, the zebra is our like mascot or whatever.
Yeah.
But it's Ehlers Danlos Awareness Month, and I always always mess around and wait till the end of the month. I'm gonna make a post too, that I want you to share, Trae. Yeah,
okay.
But
I hit now too. I mean, I'll share it.
Yeah, tell Corey to share it too.
I'll fucking raise awareness. So whatever.
He loves raising awareness. He does it all the time.
That's what you're into. Yeah. Well, awareness and blood pressure. You know what I'm saying?
Well, so I don't know what I should say about it. That's real fast. But
it don't hit.
It's a connective tissue disorder. It is genetic. So that's like a whole nother thing right now is I am pregnant. And I do feel like a lot of people are going to judge me for this, but I thought about it literally for years. And I decided like life with Ehlers-Danlos does suck at times, but I'm still glad I'm alive. So I did decide to have a kid, and my kid does have a 50% chance of having it. But
who the fuck would judge you for that?
Listen to that whole thing before.
In a hallway.
Yeah, exactly. Fuck them up. Goddamn herpes face bitches.
Yeah, I'll get my brother on you.
At least yours won't be ate up with the ugly like that little son bitch.
Yeah.
Well, don't jinx it. I mean, I don't think he will be, but, you know, I mean, and it's fine.
I'm sure he'll be fine.
But so he has a 50% chance of having it. But with boys, normally they are more symptomatic up until puberty, and then they typically do better after puberty. And some of them don't even get diagnosed with it because they're not symptomatic after puberty, whereas girls usually get way worse at puberty. So since I'm having a boy, that's hopefully he'll be good and healthy his whole life. That's what I hope for.
He's got a big fucking femur. I know that.
Two of them.
Yeah, two big ass femurs.
He's gonna be so big. Oh, I can't wait to see him. So I have hypermobile type, and there's 13 different types. So I do have the least severe as far as like with pregnancy. there is like an increased mortality rate, but it's mostly with classic and vascular kind, but I have hypermobile kind. But I'm still being monitored really closely and stuff by like a high risk doctor at Vanderbilt, and all my other doctors, and everything's going really good right now. With pregnancy, Ehlers-Danlos can actually like get so POTS, a lot of people with Ehlers-Danlos have POTS, postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, which and they're finding a lot also have mast cell activation syndrome. And they told me that there was like a small chance that I could get better during pregnancy, but like that never happens to me. So I didn't get my hopes up, and it happened.
Nice.
And I'm like the best I've been in literally like 5 years or longer.
Does this mean you're going to have like 8 kids?
Yes. Keep cranking them out, baby.
My gosh, that's the problem. I'm like, my next
that's the problem.
Stay pregnant all the time.
No.
It's already in your culture. I mean, you know.
In your DNA, girl.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
No, sure I mean,
very easily could.
But anyway, so you can find information. So I have hypermobile joints that can cause dislocations and subluxations, which is, it's really painful, and it causes a lot of joint issues and joint pain. And I have like thin, well, they say it's like velvety skin and stuff, but I have like stretchy skin, which I know that I did this.
Okay,
stuff.
You ain't got to do all that.
Yeah, you do. What? I'm supporting you.
Talking to me.
I said Trae.
Okay.
So there's healing issues. It's like.
The opposite of Wolverine.
Yeah.
There you go.
Anyway, it's a shitty disorder, and it causes a lot of other problems other than just what the Ehlers-Danlos symptoms are. But anyway, you can go to ehlersdanlos.com, and I love the Ehlers-Danlos Society if you want more information. But yeah, like I said, I'm going to post something and Trae can share it. guess what? Or one last thing. I meant to tell y'all this. Actually, there was this whole other story, but I know we don't have time for it. But I was just thinking about this when Trae said that about the
DMX.
Oh yeah, like how I texted him the day after he was thinking about it. I was, for some reason earlier today, I was thinking about our Bonnaroo thing when I like had to go to the bathroom and you thought I got lost, and you was like, Paige, you are my sister. I know you can hear me. Find me, Paige.
Yeah, I was real fucked up. Real fucked up.
I can do that, by the way.
Yeah, I'm about to say, don't, let's not, because Corey.
Corey's got the brownie.
I was doing that night. Again, I was very fucked up. Corey believes he can do that all the time. It's a power that he has.
Well, anyway.
I found Corey at Bonnaroo.
So that night, it wasn't that night. It was the next, actually, that was that was our first Bonnaroo trip. It was our second Bonnaroo trip. Anyway, where we spread Daddy's ashes.
Yes, Drew was there for that.
And then we went to Paul McCartney.
Yes.
And, like, that's the most spiritual moment
roller coaster
we ever had. Like, when they was letting all those balloons off and stuff. And, like, Hey Jude was playing. And then I have that recording on my phone of us all singing Hey Jude. And like, it was like one of the best moments of my life. And I can show Jude that now. And that ain't why I chose to name him Jude. So
that's a Jude Law, right?
No. So my baby's name is going to be Jude Neal.
Yeah.
And you know where the Neal comes from.
That's right.
Neal Peart.
DeGrasse Tyson.
Mm-hmm. After my daddy and my brother.
Ronnie.
Stop it.
And
then so I'll have that Hey Jude, like the Neil part's already special because it'll be his grandpa and his uncle's middle name. And then the Jude thing, like how cute is that gonna be when I can show him that Bonnaroo video whenever he's bigger of us all singing with the crowd at Bonnaroo during Paul McCartney after Daddy's ashes.
And then after it'd be like, but don't worry, that's not what you were named after. Yeah. That would have hit.
You should probably.
And also, he could be like, what the fuck is this?
I mean, it kind of is.
No.
No, but I'm saying it sort of is. Isn't it? Daddy was a huge Beatlemaniac, yada, yada. That ain't got nothing to do with why you picked Jude.
the name just hits for you. Because you could, at least
you could retcon it.
You could just say that, you know,
like,
you could say that part of it.
Let Trae direct your life and have a better scene.
But our dad was like a huge Beatles guy and everything. Yeah. I've just been assuming that was at least part of the rationale. So
you were telling that story, and I was like,
you should go with that.
Hey, honestly, that kind of does. I think that's why I've always liked the name Jude, but like, I can't say that because then, so like, obviously Jonathan wanted his like middle name in there, and
You get both if he knows that. Okay, I get it.
Yeah, but you've already picked it, and also what?
Yeah, well, the baby ain't born yet.
It's the man don't get to choose none of that shit.
No, never.
Don't reinvent the wheel.
I mean, I did, but inconsiderate or whatever.
Baby. So, of course, I'm going to wait until after the baby's born to say that that's why, so it don't look like I was taken.
Yes. No, I get it.
I wanted the name. I mean, obviously, me and Amber aren't even pregnant, but like, I legitimately, this is not as a joke, I wanted, because she shut it down. I wanted to name my son McNair. I thought that would hit.
Yeah.
And she's not for it at all. No Brett Favre Jr.
Yeah.
You know, Brett Favre Jr. III is what I wanted. That was the second. That was a compromise and nothing. So, like, I'm just saying, you can just do whatever you want.
Well, Jonathan said that since I wouldn't let him do Thomas, Edward, Patrick, or Brady, that he didn't care. He didn't have an opinion or whatever. He was.
Name it Gronk. Name your kid Gronk.
That was literally in the talk too, but I'm like, hey, one more thing. So next time I come on, can we talk about,
I think we're already doing that episode right now.
Oh, stop. Okay.
Next time
I come on, can we talk about, raising a kid in the South and like,
Yes, we can do all that. Yes.
Yes.
But for now, let's go. But we'll have you back in a little bit.
I love you so much. I miss y'all so much.
Go to zebrashirts.com and for awareness. What is it? Do your pitch.
Ehlersdanlos.com. Am I saying Ehlersdanlos?
Everybody says it different. I say Ehlers, but.
Ehlers. I think it is Ehlers. It's spelled Ehlers. Ehlersdanlos.com.
There you go.
Paige Crowder, everybody. See you next time. You're going to sing, Corey.
Yeah, here we go. Everybody join in if you know it. Thank you all for listening to the WellRED Show. We'd love to stick around longer, but it's been a couple weeks, but we've got to go. Tune in next week if you got nothing to do. Thank you. God bless you. Good night and ski.
Good night and ski. All right. Bye.
Bye.
They're the liberal rednecks. They like cornbread, but sex they care. But don't give a fuck. They're the liberal rednecks that makes some people upset, but they got three big old dicks that you can suck.